Every day, my company gets scam phishing emails trying to get money or sensitive info. I wanted to protect my employees and my clients, so I checked out CISA's Secure Our World. They've got simple ways we can protect our businesses from online threats. First, teach employees to recognize and report phishing. Next, require strong passwords plus multi-factor authentication. And finally, turn on automatic updates for your business software. To learn more, go to CISA at cisa.gov/secureourworld.
You're listening to a Weeby Geeks Network podcast.
Another world, another time, in the age of wonder.
There was once a dream. You could only whisper it. Anything more than a whisper, and it would vanish.
A battle between good and evil.
You don't know the power of the dark side.
Where shall I find a new adversary so close to my own level?
Try the local sewer.
You know of the rebellion against the Empire?
The Avengers, Earth's mightiest heroes.
Peace means having a bigger stick than the other guy.
One of these days, I'm going to have a stick of my own.
I'm Groot.
Welcome to the Neverland Podcast. The podcast for lovers of Disney, Pixar, Marvel, and Star Wars.
I'm glad you're here to tell us these things.
Please welcome your host, Jeremy.
I thought he'd be taller.
Yeah, I can fly.
All it takes is faith and trust.
Well, if it isn't the Star-Spangled Man with a plan, what is your plan today?
Up to Neverland!
Take your pixie out of your pockets, Neverlanders. Sprinkle some of that pixie dust around, think your happiest thoughts, and let's get ready to fly away with me. Who am I? Well, if you've been listening to this show, you should know. But if you're new here, I'm Jeremy, but you can call me the Spider-Pan. I am head lost boy around here, and I have brought our official head pixie. Hello, Wendy Nerd.
Hi.
We call her Pixie Heather, though, too.
Yep.
She doesn't say much, but that's okay.
Nope.
But she's here with us today. We're going to have some fun. We're going to talk about a ride that neither one of us ever got to experience.
I haven't ridden anything, so there's that.
Well, you've ridden something before, but you've never been to a Disney park to ride anything.
No, I have not.
And any noise you hear in the background is because our official pixie cat is here. Alora is wandering around the studio, as is happens whenever Pixie Heather gets in here, because if she's not allowed to wander around the studio, she will stand outside the door and meow.
She can't be
she's
without
spoiled,
me.
She's spoiled, and so she's climbing over anything she can find in the room.
Yeah.
So if you hear a random noise, it's just the kitty cat.
Yep.
So, but we're going to talk about the Journey into Imagination, which has had like three different titles and three different versions. But we're going to go through all the history because it's been a long time since we've added anything new to our imaginary Disney park that we have here in Neverland. So I thought that would be fun to get into some of that today. We'll also, of course, listen to some audio of the original version of that ride. We'll hear from Lost Boy Philip of his memories of actually riding the original version. But other than that, before we get started, I don't know. Some of this is housekeeping. Some of this is just, you know, what all has been going on this week would be fun. I have mentioned last week that I've started a radio show here in Clay County, Missouri on 102.7 every Saturday, 10 a.m. called Solid Rock. You can listen to that on the TuneIn app. I've got links in the show notes. Also, I'm trying to be more active. I have a Twitch channel. Normally, when I've been streaming, like, granted, I haven't done it in a while, Kingdom Hearts, I got stuck, and I haven't touched the game hardly much. I need to go and get past that Cerberus. So I haven't been playing that whole much, but I have been streaming on Twitch, and we were streaming last Friday night. I've been playing with some of the people from The Real Brian Show, like, you know, Brian from there. You've heard him on the show before, and let's see, Johnny Pistol Shot, and also the guy we know as Captain Influence on The Real Brian Show. We've been playing the Star Trek Bridge Crew game, and I did stream it on Twitch. I've recorded some video of us playing on Friday, not actually seeing us, but, you know, the gameplay. And I plan to put that on our YouTube channel so you can check that out. But make sure you go and follow us on Twitch. If you search for Neverland Podcast, you'll find the Twitch channel. Because we're going to probably do that as much as we can. And we're having fun playing Star Trek Bridge Crew. They've now got it to where you can play it with a mouse instead of your VR set. And it's the more missions we play, the harder it's getting. And the first time we played, which we didn't stream it, it was really just ridiculous. We were just kind of kidding around because the missions were pretty easy. But they got tough by about the fourth or fifth mission. Those Klingons are kicking our tails. But we're having fun. And speaking of The Real Brian Show, I actually, if you download this week's episode of The Real Brian Show, I have done a guest appearance on there talking about the Marvel movies. And if you wanted to watch Avengers Infinity War, but maybe hadn't seen all the other movies in the last 10 years, which the question would be, where have you been the last 10 years? So
a lot of people have things going on.
Yeah, I know. But it's just one of those things. And the cat just dashed out the room. Okay. Cat's being weird. But though we could talk about that, and I know what time he generally records, so maybe I'll pop up and we'll do a few more appearances over there, because it's fun. We have a good time being weird and talking about geeky things and about life. It's a good show. I think you'd enjoy it. But yeah, that's everything fun going on this week. Is there anything you want to throw in? Nope, she's just looking at me. So, all right, well, let's go ahead and jump into our news.
Spanning the Disney and geek universe to bring you the best in comics, toys, movies, and entertainment. This is news from around Neverland.
Okay, this is cool. Billy Dee Williams is coming back to play Lando one more time. Yeah! Nice. Episode 9. So all of you who have been like, oh, I hated The Last Jedi, I'll never watch another Star Wars movie. Well, I got a good incentive for you. Lando!
Yep.
Yes. And Billy Dee Williams. Of course, there might be people who just decided they're just done with it and like, well, that's okay. We'll let you just love whatever you love and not love whatever you don't love, I guess. But this is going to be fun. All we know is Lando is going to be back. And now, we've talked to Mike Quinn before on the show. He was Nine Noom. He's also the scientist in the Dark Crystal.
Okay, yep.
And he has been coming back and playing Nine Noom in these newer films. He gets to wear a full bodysuit. So I kind of hope we get him and Lando again. Maybe let them play the Falcon again together.
Just a little cameo, just a little.
So, you know, him, you know, get them to do stuff together. That would be awesome.
Just a little fan service just for
yeah,
us.
Yeah,
you know,
just. I might bug Mike Quinn because I follow him on Facebook. We're friends on Facebook. I might just ask him if he can let slip. He's like, do you know if you and Lando are going to get to do something together again? Come on. That would be great. Maybe the total geek out moment. But they're actually supposed to start production really soon. And directed by J.J. Abrams again, so he's coming back, so it's going to feel more like The Force Awakens. But this, let's see, it's supposed to begin later this summer. They're going to begin production, so it's coming up pretty soon. Of course, you know, they're trying to churn out at least a new Star Wars movie every year, so I'd say we're probably a couple years out, though, from this one, because I think we're expecting maybe another solo film. Well, not specifically a solo film, but, you know, an
independent film.
Not an independent film either, because that's not the right word to use, but a side film. We'll call it that, because solo now can mean, oh, yeah, another solo film, which we might still get, maybe. I don't know. So, it could happen. And Variety put up a block thing. All right, but you want to talk about this a little bit? But yes, did I tell you about Indy 5 was coming?
No, I think I saw something online. Maybe you posted something on Facebook or whatever. But Indiana Jones 5 apparently has been delayed.
Yeah.
July
9th, 2021 is the new date. So they basically pushed it back about a year because they were going to do it in 2020. But if that means, I guess there's issues with the script.
No. Okay.
But that doesn't bother me. You know, they push it back, take your time, make sure it's right.
Yeah, having a good one, Indiana Jones 4, I mean, it was fun.
Please no aliens.
But the particular artifact that they were looking for, I don't know, it just didn't do much for me. It didn't seem to fit within the rest of the other, you know, films very much.
It fit for being like it's one of these weird legendary artifacts, because when do some looks into crystal skulls, there's a big mystery about where those things came from.
Oh, there is. There's a lot.
Weren't we at one point promised that they were going to try to find Atlantis? Something like that would be neat.
Oh, that would be neat.
Or El Dorado. You know, well, of course, granted, if you've played Uncharted games, you've gone after El Dorado. But Indiana Jones hasn't done anything like that. But, I mean, there's, like, lost cities that would be fun. Mm-hmm. So, who knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
But I guess they've also got some dates for Dwayne Johnson, The Rock. His Jungle Cruise movie is coming out October 11th of 2019. Mm-hmm. And
Much to your chagrin, there is a Maleficent 2 coming out May 29th, 2020.
We'll skip that one. And I feel like they're only doing it because there's a real draw. They're going for as many female-led characters and heroes as they can possibly put out right now, because there's definitely a market for that. Mm-hmm. And I feel like they're only trying to feed into that market because they, you know, it is a movie company and your goal is to make money. So I think they're feeding on to it, but that first one was so bad.
Well, like it or not, it did do pretty good at the movie theater, so...
Yeah, there's a lot of bad movies that do well in the movie theater.
I know.
Well, Jurassic World, for instance.
Well, I haven't seen it.
Although that one at least is fun. You'll have a good time at that one. It's just check your brain at the door. Oh, and also Mary Poppins Returns actually is coming in a week early. It was expected to debut on December 25th of this year. It's now going to open December 19th on my sister's birthday. And I'm going to go just because I feel I should review it, but I have low expectations of trying to bring Mary Poppins back without Julie Andrews. And...
That's really hard to do. Julie Andrews really made that character and, well, all of them. You know, Dick Van Dyke, all of them that were involved. They're so classic.
Maybe Dick Van Dyke can have a cameo. He's still alive and kicking and he's capable.
Oh, yeah.
But let's cast our cares away because worries are for another day.
Here at Fraggle Rock.
No, the next line is let the music play here.
Okay, sorry. I just was jumping ahead.
You did. You jumped right ahead. Oh, look. 34th anniversary of Fraggle Rock.
Yeah.
So what do we get? We get a Blu-ray September 25th. 12 discs, all four seasons of the show, as well as the complete animated series.
Nice.
Might have to get Townsend Coleman come back on here again because he was the voice of Gobo Fraggle. We talked to him like first season.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe he can come back right about this time. I'll talk to him on Facebook. Okay. See if he'll come back and talk about Fraggle Rock. Although, I don't know if he remembered a whole lot. I remember we talked about it a little bit. But that might be fun. But this is cool. So, complete. I wonder how much this is going to cost you because it's a four-season set, 12 discs of Blu-ray.
Well, it might be worth it, you know, if you are a real Fraggle fan. We do know a Fraggle fan.
Mm-hmm. Plus, they're Muppets.
Oh, well, yeah, Muppets. I mean it's Fraggle fan or not, it's a Muppet thing.
See, new Fraggle music celebration. Oh, it's little sing-alongs for every episode. Or even you can even hit shuffle and let the Fraggles choose a song for you. And oh my gosh. Life on the set, moments with Jim Henson. A cat meowing in the background. new 1993 The Today Show segment, which Uncle Traveling Matt. Download Fraggle Rock behind the scenes. Fraggle songs and doozer music. Interviews with creators. Oh my gosh.
There's a lot of stuff on
I don't want to go through every little thing because it's a long... design of the doozers, how the trash heap came to be, Gorg designs, HBO promos. Oh, wow. So much stuff. A long list. Interviews with Jerry Jewell, Jocelyn Stevenson with Red and Mokey. Oh, wow. Wow. Okay, see, so this is... We may have to save up for this thing, but wow. Okay, so September 25th, mm-hmm. Blu-ray set. I'm hoping it's also digital, because we watch a lot of stuff digitally anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is something that's already started. You've heard of Overwatch, right?
I've heard of Overwatch, but We know
Sarah, a friend of ours, little girl. Well, she's not so little. She's a high schooler. She loves to play Overwatch. But there is an Overwatch League. There are full sets of teams, and even if you start playing Overwatch, you'll find out what's going on with the league. And this has already started. I saw this on Disney XD. The Overwatch League playoffs have started, and they're broadcasting them now live on Disney XD. They're going to recap them on ABC. You're also going to find them on ESPN and ESPN2. So, I mean, Disney XD has been showing some gaming sports like this. Mm-hmm. It's becoming a bit more legitimate for people who gamed it, you know, because they go into this, they're serious competition. They're serious about this stuff. Oh, yeah. There's a lot of money on the line. So, they're broadcasting this on TV. This is probably a pretty good move. It would be interesting if they find somewhere for, you know, games. Maybe Disney makes some things that can get into competition. You know, maybe, I don't know if the Battlefront games have been used in competition or not, but that would be Star Wars at least. But I know a lot of people have had problems with EA and how they've been handling the Battlefront games. But this is very interesting, and this, of course, is going to be broadcast on Twitch. But, you know, if you're going to watch it, go watch it on Disney XD. This started, though, already on July the 11th, and like I said, I saw some Saturday here on the 14th. I'm not sure how long these playoffs go, but go and take a look, and if you're interested in seeing that, you might be able to catch some this week. There's going to be, like I said, recaps on ABC News. But you watched a lot of Tailspin, right?
Yes, I watched a lot of Tailspin.
I never watched Tailspin.
Mm-hmm.
But here on DuckTales, you know who this character we're looking at is, right?
It's been a long time. I actually... don't.
Don Carnage!
Okay, yes. Yeah, now you mentioned the name. Yes, yes, I got it.
Yes, the consummate villain of Tailspin. And I saw one person who wasn't too happy about the design, but he matches the look of the DuckTales style for this new series.
It's a different style than what they had for Tailspin, and if you watch Tailspin and you watch DuckTales, those two styles of the old
yeah,
the
old
the
one
same
was,
as well.
Yeah,
it only makes sense.
Yeah, he's just blending in. It's still, I think he looks pretty good. Only thing is, Jim Cummings is not coming back.
Aww.
You have Jamie Camille from Jane the Virgin, and apparently he is very Broadway trained, so that's nice. Mm-hmm. And he is going to be playing the character, and Don Carnage, he says, loves to sing, he loves to dance, he loves to be the center of attention. So I guess we're going to have a singing, dancing Don Carnage, and so having a guy with some Broadway training
would
lend to that. Yeah. But you've got some big shoes to fill, buddy.
Yeah.
Because Jim Cummings is the man, okay? Mm-hmm.
Any reason why Jim Cummings, he just...
They've been, you know, because it's a different show, although I think they did get Jim Cummings to be that little brief bit with where they had Darkwing Duck make an appearance on TV. I believe they did still get Jim Cummings to do that because he created that character and that voice. So, you know, it's I still think he probably should have been Don Carnage, but, you know, he's busy while they were making, probably animating and recording these voices. He might have been busy working on this Christopher Robin movie.
Oh, yeah, so. Yeah.
But I'm sure he could have done that and the other. But, you know, then, you know, I understand you're trying to make it a little different and maybe bringing back some of the original cast would tie it too closely to the original. I don't know. But, you know, let's give him a fair shot and see how he does as the character. We got all these on the DVR. We need to sit and watch some DuckTales. Really, really behind. But I don't know if I want to dive necessarily into a trailer park, but there was like a, they called it a sneak peek. It was about a minute and a half of Christopher Robin, by the way.
Another gator got in the house.
Another gator? Give me that shovel. Come here.
Oh. Get him, Mom. Oh. Get that gator.
The Neverland Trailer Park.
I have to stay for work.
Father, I never see you.
Your life is happening now, right in front of you.
I am sorry.
What to do, what to do.
What to do indeed.
Who?
Christopher Robin. No.
You're here in London?
I haven't seen you in years.
I've lost all of my friends. We need to find them. Well, hello there. Are you on an expedition? Oh, bother.
Pooh! Look, people can't see you moving and talking.
But why?
Just try and be a less exuberant you.
Exuberant?
Play nap time.
I love play.
Well, let's see it.
Like this.
Well done.
House. Clouds. Tree.
Pooh, what are you doing?
Oh, I'm playing say what you see.
Well, could you say what you see a little more quietly?
House, grass, trees.
Christopher Robin!
He's giant!
Oh, and he smells a little funny.
Leora, I'll save you!
Just an average Wednesday morning.
One foot in front of the other.
It's always a sunny day.
Come on, let's bounce! Piglet!
When Christopher Robin comes to play.
Silly old bear.
Disney's Christopher Robin. Rated PG. Get tickets now.
I gotta say, everything I see new on this, I get more excited.
Yeah, it looks like it's gonna be fun.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'm hesitant about the whole mix of real rife with your childhood.
Real rife?
Real rife, yes, real rife.
Real rife, all right, Scooby.
Yes. anyway, I can't get, you know, because it's gotta be handled just right. Otherwise, it comes off kind of cheesy and it just doesn't work. But this really...
You can be cheesy with Winnie the Pooh and it works, though.
Well, okay. You know what I'm talking about.
Pooh can be cheesy. Maybe Christopher Robin in the real world doesn't have to be cheesy, but Pooh can be a little cheesy.
But this was, it's just the right amount of, like, you know, Pooh's older and Christopher Robin's older. Like,
but Pooh shouldn't age, really. Pooh should just be who he is.
Well, no, like, as a toy. Like, oh, you know, that's why I always took it as he's an older toy. He's been out in the elements, and if you know, if you've had a toy that's you've loved for a long time, it kind of fades over time. So it makes sense to me.
The colors of the characters, they do look kind of muted. Like
they do
been,
look
like
they're
older
a little older. I mean, because they're not going to grow up, but they could fade.
Yeah. And they do kind of look faded. Tigger really looks very faded, but he's, you know, he lives his kind of crazy, rough lifestyle. He's probably, you know, it makes sense he might be a little bit more worn because he's bouncing everywhere. But I love that they have established that instead of just all this in Christopher Robin's imagination that he imagined his little world, mm-hmm. is that somehow or another now the 100-acre wood is real. And yes, these animals, these characters talk. Mm-hmm. Because we see a clip in here where Winnie the Pooh talks to somebody while they're walking down the street and he's under Christopher Robin's arm.
Yeah.
And he talks to another guy that walked past, are you on an expedition too? And the guy like panic, like, what in the world? And then bump right into a pole.
Yeah.
And then Christopher Robin takes him into a phone booth and is like, Pooh, you can't go talking to people.
Yep.
They're not going to understand, so you have to act like a normal teddy bear. And Pooh's like, I don't know how to do that. So like, I know, let's play a game that you're taking a nap. And it's really cute. They just so Pooh kind of lean over into the phone booth. Bonk.
Yep.
It's just so cute. I want a Winnie. If they will make some toys, I guarantee,
oh, I bet they
movie
will.
Style. I want one. I want a Pooh. Yeah. That sounds like a funny voice. I want a Pooh.
Yep. Well, we can get you a Pooh. They have a little, you know, plush Poohs anymore.
I do have one that's more like preschool thing. He's got some fun textures. I got a Pooh, but he's so cute in this movie. And they even have a neat little scene they show in this sneak peek where they're riding on the train and Pooh's playing the name everything he sees game. Mm-hmm. And so there's a tree and there's some grass. It reminded me a lot of the Dr. Dolittle tree. He's you know, doing that. And Christopher Robin asked him, can you do that little choir? And it's not really like this big grand thought out joke, but because it's Pooh, it works. And he's going, tree, grass. You know, he starts whispering. Mm-hmm. He's quieter. And it's so cute and endearing. You're just like, yay, it's Pooh. Because he thinks does exactly the way we expect Pooh to be.
Mm-hmm.
I'm so excited.
He's just a silly old bear.
He just does what he does.
Yep. So we're excited about this.
And I want a t-shirt that says, like, people say nothing is impossible, but I do nothing every day. Because that's part of Pooh. He says the most simple things that are almost so genius, but yet so simple. I'm like, that's why we love Pooh. And I love that. I want a shirt. If they make that shirt, I want that shirt because that's kind of true.
But you got to make sure you have like a little, like the little tree with a little portal, like to go into like 100-acre
like
wood or something like
something
that
on there.
That, yep.
If I tried to lift that line and created my own shirt, there would be for sale. I bet I'd get in trouble though.
Oh, you probably would.
I would love to be able
Disney
to do that in Little Neverland. Yeah.
And,
let's not make the Disney people happy and shut me down or unhappy and shut me down. Yeah. Okay. Make them mad. Yeah. Let's make them happy and not do that so they don't come and shut me down.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Well, I'm so looking forward to that. And I'll be out of town when it comes out.
Well,
if it comes out that Saturday, maybe I can drive home that Friday night after my conference. I don't know. I need to figure out how that's going to work. There will be a week, this first week in August. I'm not exactly how the show is going to come about. I may have to record it really early. You might just get to hear some convention audio. I'll put something together, but I'm going to be at a conference for a couple weeks, so it could be tricky, but I got to make sure I see that movie. But we might not be able to review the movie necessarily that week, but we are definitely going to have to talk about that movie because I am super excited the more I see about it because, like, yay.
No, I couldn't tell.
I am so yay because I love these characters and I love it when they're handled correctly. I mean, because that Winnie the Pooh that they just called Winnie the Pooh was okay, and at least they pulled some stories from the book. But I don't know, it was missing something. Maybe I need to watch it again. I mean, it was okay, but I somehow know that the charm was gone. But however, this movie, I know the charm is there.
Yeah,
the charm of the original. So I'm excited.
What to do? What to do?
What to do? Indeed,
Pooh.
Christopher Robin.
Everybody knows Winnie the Pooh. Whether you know him from A. Milne's books or from Disney's cartoons, he's really alive as a character in people's imaginations.
However, did you recognize me?
You haven't changed a bit.
These are the characters that my generation, my parents' generation, and now this generation are growing up with.
You're the bear in my father's drawings.
Winnie the Pooh became a dear friend of mine when Walt gave us the assignment to write songs for the first Winnie the Pooh short film. And here, so many years later, it is very special to be back in the 100-acre wood.
Well, I didn't expect to be here today.
Disney are doing a great job of bringing some of their archive characters to life. And it's exciting to be involved in Christopher Robin.
Hello, everyone.
It's Christopher Robin!
Winnie the Pooh comes back to him in a difficult time in his life.
Christopher Robin always comes to save us. Now it's our turn to save him.
He sort of speaks a lot of truth, Pooh.
It would appear that I am stuck.
Have you just eaten honey?
The whole new generation is being introduced to this beloved character is something very exciting.
Hello, everyone.
Oh, hello.
This is a charming story of a man finding his home again and finding that in a child.
Silly old bear.
It really is a lovely, funny adventure. We'll come out the better for it, having seen it, I think.
Come on, let's bounce!
To Disney and beyond.
Oh! Journey into Imagination actually was created by Tony Baxter and Steve Kirk. Tony Baxter, let's face it, he's the most beloved Imagineer of our current time, I guess. I mean, he's really behind a lot of things. Wow, my brain just went right out the window. I'm going to end up mentioning it later on the show when you hear me talking with Lost Boy Philip. But the Big Thunder Mountain is one of his babies. You know, he's done a lot of stuff, had really great ideas. He's done so much. But the ride opened on March 15th of 1983, and you would ride on an Omnimover, like you would see in the Haunted Mansion, and you're basically people are floating on clouds until you're going to see this interesting flying device, this little silhouette in the distance.
So the vehicle is seen as a silhouette of a blimp, kind of crossed with a vacuum cleaner. I think I've seen you show me some clips of this.
Mm-hmm.
So the next thing that we were going to see is that you're going to get close enough to see the vehicle that some people call the Dream Catcher and then some people call the Dream Mobile. But then you meet the Dream Finder, and he is a little man, kind of odd looking, with a top hat.
Colorful.
So he's got a blue suit and a red beard, so colorful. And then the Dream Finder was voiced by the late and great Chuck McCann.
Yep, Chuck McCann just passed away here this past April. He was a very prolific actor, and I think we're going to remember him both for being Burger Beagle and Bouncer Beagle of the Beagle Boys and Duckworth, all from the original DuckTales. He's got a long list of other different characters that he did when I looked on IMDb. Too much to list here, but I even saw he was popping up on the Gummy Bears and that Winnie the Pooh animated series, which please somebody put that out on DVD. I loved the old Winnie the Pooh series. I watched it every Saturday. Adored it. Especially, I don't know why, but I always remember the episode where they had the Western. It was kind of funny, and they had Winnie the Pooh riding around on Eeyore, was his supposed to be his faithful steed.
I didn't see that.
Who was that masked bear? Oh, it was adorable. I loved it. It was a great one, but he's got a lot of things he did. And Chuck McCann, actually, when the ride opened, he went around and he would dress as the Dream Finder, and he would be in the park, and he had a puppet of Figment that he'd have on his shoulder so he could move the puppet around.
That would be fun. He could greet people.
There's even some footage, if you look on YouTube, of him appearing on some news shows to promote, you know, because Epcot was fairly new and it was very different. And you'll hear from Philip later how, you know, kids were like, this is an educational park. I don't want to go to it. They didn't realize how much fun was actually there at Epcot. So they really were giving it that push.
So in the ride, the Dream Finder is going to create and then reveal a little friend, which became the star of the original Epcot Center. And his name was Figment.
I was thinking, you know, when I wrote this up, Eric would probably sing this to you. You don't know this tune. Do you know this tune?
Well, you've played it for me, but I don't think I'm going to sing it.
Yeah.
So it's just like, two tiny wings, eyes big and yellow, horns of a steer, but a lovable fellow. From head to tail, he's royal purple pigment, and there, voila, you've got a Figment.
Yay, a Figment of imagination.
Mm-hmm.
And Figment was originally voiced by also the late and great Billy Barty. And most of us are going to remember him from Willow and also Masters of the Universe. Even if it wasn't a great film, he was fun in there. He was as Gwildor. Together, the Dream Finder and Figment begin to imagine new things, and they place them all into an idea bag. And then Dream Finder announces that the bag is full, and we must head off to the Dreamport to go and empty it out, which is never far away when we use our imagination.
Yep. So then the Omnimover leaves the side of the Dreammobile and enters the Dreamport storage room, which includes a massive contraption for sorting ideas. Also in the room, there are numerous objects, including boxed applause, a plasma ball, a birdcage of musical notes. After leaving the storage room, the ride continued through several rooms representing art, literature, performing arts, and science. The art room was mostly white-colored and had a large painting the Dreamfinder was making using a large fiber optic paintbrush and a carousel with giant carousel animals and a pot of rainbows held by Figment.
The literature room was mostly focused on suspenseful tales and had Dreamfinder playing a massive organ with words coming out of it. And these words turned into their meanings. I've seen some video of this. This looks amazing. I wish it was still there. A massive book featuring the raven from Edgar Allan Poe's poem, cawing menacingly, and books of horrible monsters Figment tried to keep closed.
That'd be fun.
Yeah, the performing arts had Figment trying on costumes backstage while Dreamfinder conducted a laser light show in the manner of an orchestra conductor. The last of the rooms, science, featured a large machine that Dreamfinder was opening that took a closer look at the workings of nature, such as the growth of plants, the formation of crystals from minerals, and looking into space.
And then at the end, Dreamfinder tells Figment and the audience that imagination is the key to unlocking the hidden wonders of the world. The ride then enters the final show scene. As the writer's pictures are taken, they see Figment surrounded by several movie screens of him being a scientist, a mountain climber, a pirate, a superhero, a tap dancer, a ship captain, a cowboy, and an athlete. Dreamfinder, who is behind a movie camera, gives the writers one last inspiring message and tells them to use their newly found sparks of imagination in the image works, and which is the on-ride photo, is shown on the screen next to the camera. The ride closed, unfortunately, on October 10th, 1998, in order to begin a major renovation of the attraction.
Yeah, the on-ride photo is actually shown on a screen next to the camera. The image works, you're going to get to play with the picture, from what my understanding. So that's what they're talking about. We do have some audio from Lost Boy Philip. We also call him Kryptonian, where he actually got a chance to experience the ride. So let's stop and take a listen to that. All right, so continuing our talk with the original Journey into Your Imagination, as it was first called. Eric and I, neither one of us ever got to ride this, but Lost Boy Philip got to ride this thing. So,
oh, yeah, several times.
So you can actually tell us more from a personal experience. I mean, we're going through the history of the ride, and that's one thing, and we can listen to the audio, but there's a difference between that and actually experiencing it.
Yes.
The way it used to be.
Well, to be completely honest with you, when we were little kids, I was 9 years old, and we went to Disney World, and this is our second time to get to go. And we were very excited, of course, to go to Magic Kingdom. We always love the Magic Kingdom.
Of course.
And adore it, you know. But the fact is we weren't all that excited about going to the Epcot Center, us kids. My father, being a nut of history and things, and pardon the term nut, but we were really, he's excited about going and all these other things. And he was trying to explain to us it's going to be a lot of fun, he said. And then I got to be honest, it didn't sound fun because he said it's going to be a lot of science and this kind of stuff for a kid who goes to school. And we take science classes, and I tell you, it was going down on the mark as this is going to stink. But then we get there, and we see everything, the great big silver ball, you know, that, as we took it. And it looked awesome. But we go in there and still thought, this isn't going to be much fun. But then we get to this ride where there's this little purple dragon, and we've seen him all over as you're walking in. There's a guy who's dressed like a magician, and he has at the time, they had him holding a puppet, and he was doing the little Figment puppet.
Yeah, that was Chuck McCann for the longest time. Yeah. He was going around as the Dreamfinder.
And, Epcot had only been open for, at that time, it had been open for like 4 years, so it was still pretty new.
Yeah, the first ride opened in 1983, time.
So then it had only been...
Yeah, it hadn't been that long.
I think it opened, I'm talking about the actual park, it only been open for...
Well, yeah, 81 is when Epcot opened, and then the Journey into Your Imagination was in 1983. And Chuck McCann was going around as the Dreamfinder, had a puppet of Figment. I would love to have seen that.
Yeah, so by the time we got there, he'd only been around for about 3 years, because we went in 86, and we'd had someone a year before visit and told us that it was really fun. We ought to go. We like it. So we go there, and I just was really skeptical about it. But when we went to the Journey of Imagination, that is what, that ride is what changed everything for me personally and my brothers and my sister. That was the ride that made Epcot Center not only one of the coolest experiences, but it is what made Epcot probably our favorite park there, which was amazing, because anything that could turn me around from loving Magic Kingdom, by the way, I still adore Magic Kingdom, that will always be the number one park for me. But that being said, Epcot Center is just absolutely amazing, and I never would have thought that it had not been for Figment, and I love Figment. He will always be one of my absolute favorite characters, especially for a non-cartoon character. He didn't have his own movies. Mm-hmm. He didn't have any of that. He was from the park only.
Yeah.
And I love him. I just absolutely love him. Plus which, and I didn't really know him at the time, but now I do, Billy Barty.
Yeah.
I love him. I absolutely adore Billy Barty, and I always will. I didn't know that I did know him. He had been on an episode of The Waltons. Yeah,
he'd been in a lot of stuff.
Yeah, and I didn't know all that. I didn't know that he was a guy who'd been in a lot of movies and a lot of things. Of course, I would come to know him from movies like Masters of the Universe.
Yes.
Yes, you know, of course, Willow would just be a year later.
Still my favorite, Willow.
Oh, how can you beat
favorite
it?
Favorite role for him.
Oh, he was just great. And then one of the last things he did, he was a voice on Rescuers Down Under. He was this little bitty mouse,
thing.
Yeah, that's pretty much what he said. Yeah.
I haven't seen that in a long time.
Which is a great
movie. And I
have
it on Blu-ray.
Yeah, it's a great movie. It's a wonderful movie.
I don't think it's as good as the original, but
you know what I like about it? The animation
is great.
It really caught my imagination. Plus which, you have that eagle, which is just outstanding animation. That's the Glenn there. He did a great job. But anyway, it was wonderful. But Billy Barty, you gotta love him. And Figment, what a great character. I love it. I just love Journey of Imagination. And I tell you what, as a child, if that ride hadn't been there, I don't know that I would have gone back to Epcot. I would have, because my dad would have made me. But the point is that was it. That ride was outstanding. It was outstanding. And I thank you. Whoever came up with that idea, I thank you, I love you, and I always will.
And that was, oh my gosh, and his name just went right out of my head. Everybody's favorite Imagineer, though, pretty much, though. And now I cannot, oh my gosh. We're going to have said it before in the show.
Yeah.
Wow.
You'll come up with it later and you'll edit it in there.
And I can see him in my head, his mustache, his gray head, and everything.
Huh.
Oh, wow. But he's the one who was worked on that one. And he did, you know, like Big Thunder Mountain. He worked on the Phantom Manor in Paris. He was working on a different ride in Walt Disney World where the Pirates of the Caribbean ended up going in instead because in Florida they decided they wanted a Pirates of the Caribbean. And why in the world did my brain just shut down?
It happens.
Because he has since left the Disney company.
Because
they don't make things the way he does and it did anymore. So he doesn't feel that he was really being that useful.
Well, I wish they had more rides like he makes, I'll tell you that.
He's got quite a few, but I cannot think all the ones that he was like the head guy, and I cannot think of the dude's name. Wow. Well,
I tell you,
that's awful.
When they moved away in...
Editing happening.
When they went to a different Imagination ride, I don't know what they call it now.
They went from Journey into Your Imagination into Journey into Imagination, and then became Journey into Imagination with Figment, because they realized they needed to bring Figment back, because people were not liking the
ride.
It's
still not as good as it was.
They didn't fix it.
Yeah, it's still not as good as it was, but it's okay. At least it has Figment.
Yeah.
And I like that. I mean... It's got some good. What's his name? Billy.
You got Eric Idle.
Eric
in there,
Idle.
Which,
man.
You gotta love Eric Idle, but somehow the ride doesn't have the same charm.
It doesn't, and I love that original ride. Of course, you know, a lot of this is sentiment, you know. But that being said, it just had a certain. I don't know if you want to say flair about it or whatever.
It was more fanciful. It wasn't like any real science. It was this guy in a goofy contraption that captured things and took them to the dream port go and create stuff to imagine. And when they turned it into a scientific thing, I think that's where they lost some of it.
That was something about the old Epcot that I love, though. The whole park had these wonderful songs, and everything had this sense about it where every ride you felt like you was taking an adventure, even when it was about science. They had songs about it, and it would take you into there, and it helped you to understand. That's why I really loved it, because I wasn't much of a science guy, but yet I understood.
You were no Bill Nye, right?
That's it. Thank you. But at the same time, I was enjoying it, and I learned a lot. I really enjoyed it.
And even like Spaceship Earth, it's the first thing I remember when I rode in there. Spaceship Earth is amazing,
it's really
a simple thing.
And it had a song too, a different one. But it was really nice. I loved it all.
And so did you get to ride that one when it had Walter Cronkite? I think he was the first voice.
Yeah, they had so many different things then than they have now.
And then I would love to have heard the Jeremy Irons on Spaceship Earth. I've heard the audio of that. Oh, Jeremy Irons was awesome.
I've gotten to go through most of them, at least in the original. Let's see. I'm trying to think how many times I got to go. I went in 91. The first one was 86. I went again in 91. I'm trying to think of how many times I got to go. I got to go, I want to say, in 97. So I got to go several times, you know, and I got to say, and I want to tell you something. As far as the Journey to Imagination, when we would go there, only God knows how many times we'd ride it.
Like, we gotta go! And then suddenly it was Eric Idle. It was kind of nice that they tied it in with Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
Oh, that was nice,
which, you know, Honey, I Shrunk the Audience was at the time, and tying it in there. That was kind of a neat thing.
Also, what they did that was wise, at the time, whenever I went to the ride the first time, one thing they had just, and I mean just, and wasn't even out at one point when they had put it in there. But
Tony Baxter! I knew it would come to me. Tony Baxter!
There you go. Yes, they tied it up with him. No.
He's the guy responsible.
Well, it was very smart was they put it with Flubber. And that was smart.
Yeah,
because that was brand new. And
picture on the wall.
So that was smart. It's kind of nice to see that he's still involved in some way.
I think they still have that picture on the wall.
Yeah, so that's kind of nice.
From what I've heard. Because I haven't been... When I was at Epcot, we didn't ride it. So we were...
really tired from Animal Kingdom. Yeah. So we didn't get very far.
Yeah.
I had no idea how much stuff was in Epcot.
I know. It's impossible to know until you're there. You're like, holy cow.
Yeah, because we did, like, Test Track, and we did the Mission to Mars, and we did Spaceship Earth.
Yeah.
And then we went out and rode Maelstrom, which I'm glad I did because now it's gone.
Yeah.
But never got on the Journey to Imagination. But I did get all those comics. Have you ever gotten to read those? I think I loved them.
Yeah, the first one. I haven't got through the second one yet.
Yeah, because there's two of them.
Eventually I will.
Which... So I think I loaned the first one too, but I think you found yourself a booklet of it though.
I never have gotten it though.
I never did. Okay,
but you did get
a chance to read them, and I don't know if you still have them or if I still have them.
I'll get back to you.
Okay, I've got them probably with the second one somewhere. But yes, the comics. It was great to have Figment and the Dreamfinder back, and to give an origin story to the Dreamfinder.
Yeah, it took me. I remember at first I was like, "Man, this is good," but it just doesn't seem like the Dreamfinder. Then by the end, you're like, "That's him."
Yeah, when he becomes the Dreamfinder, we all know.
Yeah, that's him. And I was excited by the end of it. I just remember telling my wife, "I want to read this again sometime," and I am going to buy it at some point.
Yeah, because they have released them as full volumes.
And that's what I usually like to do.
Yeah, I get the collection.
So that makes it fun.
And what got me excited on that, because I was familiar with the song, is the part where he's creating Figment when he's got the thing on, and it goes and quotes the whole thing.
Yes, you know,
two tiny wings. Whatever, I can't remember the whole thing.
But a lovable fellow.
Yes. Oh, and then even when Figment pops out, he's...
I'm hearing Billy Barty the whole time.
Yes.
Every time I see him, it's funny how characters can do that for you.
Yeah.
But whenever I am reading anything from him in that comic book, I'm hearing Billy Barty.
Yeah.
There's never going to be another Figment for me but Billy Barty. Yeah. That's
Even though I still love Dave Gold.
Oh, he did great.
I love him better as Gonzo than I do as Figment, though.
But he did good at keeping the Billy Barty spirit.
Yes, he did.
And I have to give him kudos for that. You know,
because
he did a great job.
Awesome.
He was really good at that. That's the thing, when you have an original guy do a voice, or girl do a voice, the person behind him has to try their best to keep a little bit of that.
Yeah, keep the spirit. Try to make sure that you can believe that they are that character.
And this is not a put down to the man. I can't think of his name right now. Sherlock Holmes, the newer one.
The new Sherlock, the BBC series?
Yeah.
With
shoot, I
now
like
that
him.
Name went out of my head.
Cumberbatch.
Doctor Strange, Cumberbatch. Yeah, Benedict. Cumberbatch.
I really like him. I like him a lot. But in the new Grinch movie coming out,
he sounds so different.
I don't like him as Grinch. And it sounds terrible to say. I haven't even seen it yet because it's not out yet. But I do want to see it. It looks good. But
you know he's capable of getting that tone.
Yes.
And that's probably when they cast him what they were expecting he was going
to
do.
They told him not to. I don't know. But I kept thinking, this isn't the Grinch. At least Jim Carrey, and I did not like that movie at all. But by the way, that's just my personal opinion. But I got to say, at least
he was trying to be the Grinch.
Yeah, he tried to be the Grinch. Because that Grinch was the Grinch. He's the original Grinch in animation. And
we
tried to be that. So that's way with the Figment. I was glad that they kept him Figment-ish.
Yes, exactly.
But I really love that ride. And I'm glad that they got him around. I do wish and hope that someday they bring that ride back the way it once was. And I know I'm older.
They probably still have the recordings. And, you know, they'd probably have to pay some royalties into Billy Barty's family. And I think...
And that'd be fine.
Okay, so the attraction reopened on October 1st, 1999 as Journey into Your Imagination, and it featured an updated theme based on the 3D movie Honey, I Shrunk the Audience. So now guests would take a tour of the Imagination Institute and be test subjects for a new invention, the Imagination Scanner, with Dr. Nigel Channing, played by Eric Idle, and he, of course, hosted this version of the ride.
Public opinion of the Journey into Your Imagination was generally negative. Figment's appearances in the experience were reduced to cameos in the Q movies, a constellation in the Connection Lab, and at the end of the ride, where he's only heard, but shoot off by Channing. Fans were mainly upset that the Dreamfinder, a popular character from the original ride, was not present in this version. Additionally, the ride path was drastically shortened due to budgetary issues. Because of this, the attraction closed October 8th, 2001, and again went through another renovation.
Then it becomes Journey into Imagination with Figment. They thought putting Figment's name back on would try to get everybody to come back and give them another try. They still didn't bring back the Dreamfinder, though. So the attraction reopened again on June 2nd, 2002. Now, as I said, Journey into Imagination with Figment. So Figment returns into a larger role and appearing in every show scene. And the song One Little Spark also comes back with some new verses. Although I don't think it's as much fun as the original, personally. Although the Dreamfinder, of course, as we said, still absent.
At this time, the Institute has five labs based on the five human senses, sight, sound, smell, touch, and taste. Dr. Nigel Channing of the Imagination Institute, which is Eric Idle, okay, invites guests to the Institute's open house. Figment, which was voiced by Dave Goles, tags along, much to Channing's dismay, and causes mischief along the way.
Yeah, and as you heard me and Philip say earlier, we love Dave Goles because we love Gonzo and his work with the Muppets. But he's just, and like he did try, you know, he does a very good Figment, but it's not quite the same as Billy Barty.
Billy Barty had a very distinct voice.
Well, in the sound area, Figment is going to interrupt the experiment, and he comes up with a telephone and the train sound from the previous version of Now a Train of Thought.
Inside, Figment knocks the letters off the room's eye chart and begins to sing along to One Little Spark. The materializing butterfly from the old version was carried over from the previous version, but rather than appearing in the cage, the effect is now reversed so that the butterfly disappears.
In the smell room, Figment becomes a skunk, which blasts the rioters with a foul odor, which is actually burnt coffee smell.
I don't know if that's any better than a skunk, but...
Well, yeah, I don't know.
I don't know.
They're good at finding ways to stink you out in a Disney park. Just talk to everybody who doesn't like Stitch's Great Escape. That's the biggest complaint I hear is the chili dog burp.
Oh.
And it's foul.
Okay. After seeing the chaos Figment has been causing, Channing stops the tour outside the Touch and Taste Labs, abandoning the tour. Figment takes the riders to his own open house, which he literally turns upside down with his carefree mind. Channing soon learns from Figment that imagination should be set free. Kind of if you can't beat them, join them. And the writers go into the finale with numerous Figments in various situations, while Figment and Channing sing One Little Spark from the moon together while the writers disembark for the Image Works.
Yeah, so Channing is actually the moon himself.
The moon, oh.
That's kind of fun.
Okay.
So they really tried hard to make it fun, but I don't know, it's just, it's missing some of its charm. An homage to the initial incarnation of this attraction can be found on an office door in the initial showroom under the name Dean Finder, of course alluding to Dreamfinder.
Both the 1999 and 2002 versions were created by Tom Fitzgerald.
The Kodak Company ended its sponsorship of the pavilion in August 2010 after nearly 28 years. So we're still hopeful maybe they find a way to bring back something of the original. They might have to pay something to Chuck McCann's family and Billy Barty's family, but maybe they can restore it to its former glory, because I love Eric Idle.
Yeah.
But I don't know, somehow they missed it. Now, Eric Idle maybe could play the Dreamfinder.
Yeah.
If they'd have done that. But I don't know, Chuck McCann was just so great. That, I don't know, Eric Idle, I think, he could play an interesting version of the Dreamfinder.
Oh, yeah.
He could have pulled it off. He still could.
He's well-known for quirky characters and all that.
I bet he'd have been a lot of fun as the Dreamfinder. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I don't know, maybe they can do something new, try to go back more to the original style, because even without Chuck McCann and Billy Barty, I bet you could still kind of bring back the characters and give Eric Idle another chance at it, maybe. I don't know. I don't know why they felt they needed to change it. I don't understand. I don't know the reasoning behind shutting it down and making it new. Granted, they always like to update things, keep things fresh. Mm-hmm. But sometimes when they update and change things, they make something that's not as good as the original. It does happen.
Well, I mean, I could see as the technology advances...
Yeah, you want to update
they may
want
to, you know, freshen it up so it takes advantage of the new technology to do, you know, 3D stuff and things like that and make it more imaginative and exciting. I think that would be fine.
Yeah,
but there is a fine line there that you have to ride between honoring the original and not getting too excited about the technology and go down that rabbit hole.
Yeah, it's possible that you can plus a ride without altering it entirely. Hence, I guess what they've tried to do with Pirates of the Caribbean, although their plussing and changing of characters has altered the ride severely, and that's getting some mixed reviews right now. Some people are saying, well, this is fine, and other people are saying, no, this isn't great. But I do have some audio of the original ride.
Yay.
So we can take a ride on it right now.
A dream can be a and you. One little spark of inspiration is at the heart of all creation. Right at the start of everything that's new, one little spark lights up for you. Oh, hello there. So glad you could come along. I am the Dream Finder. Musical notes. What delightful melodies those will make. I love these flights of fancy, searching the universe for sounds, colors, ideas, anything that sparks the imagination. A sunbeam. That's a good one. Oh, everything I collect can inspire amazing and marvelous new ideas. And you never know what kind of figment you may come up with. Oh, here's my favorite. Two tiny wings, eyes big and yellow, horns of a steer, but a lovable fellow. From head to tail, he's royal purple pigment, and there, voila! You've got a figment of imagination.
Dream Finder, I'm just right.
Not quite.
Huh?
I'll throw in a dash of childish delight. Look, Figment, some new friends have joined us.
Can they imagine too?
Of course. Imagination is something that belongs to all of us.
You mean everyone can think up new things.
That's right, Figment. And every sparkling idea can lead to even more. So many times, we're stumbling in the dark, and then, eureka! What a spark!
How are we going to use lightning?
We can combine it with ghostly shivers on a stormy night and turn them into a tale of fright.
Look, a rainbow. How do you use that to paint with?
Now you've got it.
Wow. Numbers, letters, papers for writing, costumes, makeup, stages for mining, teardrops, laughter.
What about science?
Science? We'll need electron beams and crystal prisms, gyroscopes and magnetism, holy grail.
Hold on, Pigment.
Why?
The idea bag is full.
It is? Let's start making new things.
No, wait. First, we must store these ideas with the others in the Dream Port.
Are we almost there?
Well, the Dream Port is never far away when you use your imagination.
Come on, everybody, let's
go! We all have sparks. Imagination.
Yeah.
That's how our minds create creations. Right at the start of everything that's new, one little spark lights up for you.
Oh, boy!
Imagination, imagination. A dream can be a dream come true with just that spark in me and you. Red and gold from autumn flowers, purple and blue from twilight hours, green summer hills and rainbows play a part, a painter's brush, a work of art. Mix red and gold from autumn flowers.
Thank you.
might shriek or killer can spark the mind to start a thriller. Add some more sparks like dagger, blood, and gory, and then a mystery story. One chilling word. Some happy songs.
Some snappy dances.
Costumes and sets.
Moves and romances.
With flashing tears and footlights all aglow. The sparks ignite.
A brand new show. Some happy songs.
Some happy songs.
Some snappy dances.
Some snappy dances.
Costumes and sets.
Costumes and sets.
Moves and romances. With flashing tears. What about science? Technology, like a newfound potion, allows us to marvel at mysteries of motion. Water dances where visions begin. Science reveals the life within. I'll wind this dial and time escapes. Watch minerals change to crystal shapes. Let's look at nature at this speed, from germination, then back to seed. Skyrocket, soar towards outer space. Imagine yourself in an infinite place. Oh, there are so many places to dream about.
We can visit worlds that were, that could be, and those of fantasy and reality.
I bet I can use imagination to discover all kinds of new things.
Of course. It's your key to unlock the hidden wonders of our world.
Imagination. A dream come true. One spark in me and you.
Imagination. We all have sparks. Imagination. That's how our minds create creations. Oh, they can make our wildest dreams come true. Those little sparks in me and you.
Okay, well, I think we should wrap this up.
Okay.
So that was fun.
Yeah.
And now that song's gonna be stuck in your head. And I can't help it. Yeah. That little song, when they start singing Imagination, I see SpongeBob and his little fingers in his room going, Imagination. Yes. So SpongeBob would be right at home hanging out with Figment.
Yes.
So, but that's all we got for this week.
Thank you for listening to the Neverland Podcast.
We invite you back next week for more fun and adventure.
Until then, remember to keep a pixie in your pocket.
It's that young at heart, positive attitude that you can share with others.
And remember to visit our website at neverlandpodcast.com.
There you can find links to our news page, our shop,
our contact page, where you can easily send an email to podcast@neverlandpodcast.com.
You can also find our Neverlanders page, where you can find out how to become an official Lost Boy or Pixie, because girls are too clever to get lost.
Become a real Neverlander.
Please feel free to leave us a voicemail at 816-226-6492.
And be sure to follow us on Twitter at NeverlandPCast.
And like our Neverland Podcast fan page on Facebook.
We also have a group on Facebook for you to join.
We also appreciate your support to keep the Neverland Podcast up and running.
Visit patreon.com/neverlandpodcast to donate to keeping the pixie dust alive.
Copyright content featured on the Neverland Podcast is copyright of their respective creators and used under fair use license.
All original content is copyright of Blue Band Productions, and a very special thanks to Yeehaw Bob Jackson at yeehawbob.com for our new ending music.
God bless!
Yeah! Hello everybody, this is Yeehaw Bob Jackson. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, we love you. Neverland Podcast, it's true. Neverland Podcast, we love you.
Yay!
Ew, gotta get rid of this old Backstreet Boys t-shirt.
Tell me why.
Because it stinks, boys.
Tell me why.
I've washed it so many times, but the odor won't come out.
Tell me why.
No, you tell me why I can't get rid of this odor.
Have you tried Downy Rinse and Refresh? It doesn't just cover up odors. It helps remove them.
Wow, it worked, guys.
Yeah.
Downy Rinse and Refresh removes more odor in one wash than the leading value detergent in three washes. Find it wherever you buy laundry products.